Bienvenido.
Amen.
Well, let's start with 2 Timothy. If we'll open up our Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Second Timothy, chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. And it reads, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." It's telling us that if we read our Bibles, if we study them diligently, that we can be set on a path towards perfection. And at this camp meeting, we're talking about being sanctified, about perfecting our characters. And I just, in this talk, wanted to just go over the Bible as being a base, but also, you know, it's what we feed ourselves with. We have avenues of our soul, our senses, and we need to make certain that we're fortifying ourselves with the things of God rather than the things of this world. And the Bible is a perfect lesson book that we're to fill ourselves with. And I started putting this sermon together when I was in Peru. I was in Peru in mid-April, and I was able to go around and visit with different people, and it was quite a new experience for me. But as I went about and as I talked and conversed with people, especially with my mother, I understood that the Peru was changing. It was becoming what we would call westernized. Of course, Peru is in the West, but it's becoming modern. And we went into some people's homes, and all that they would be doing is watching television. We'd be there talking, and there'd be football, what we call soccer, on the television. And as a society, they were moving away from a moral basis to a more worldly basis. The whole world seems to be moving away from morality. And it's frightening to think that even God's church is, not God's church, but those who claim to be God's church are doing the same, even some within God's church. And I grew up being a television junkie myself. I was influenced to do certain things, to buy certain things. And it's just amazing the power that it has over people. This may seem like I'm shifting the subject a little bit, but I wanted to talk about an experiment that scientists like to perform on certain test subjects. And these are people who have suffered from having seizures. And if they're bad enough, they have their hemispheres severed apart so that you don't have that problem of the seizure. But this means that the hemispheres can no longer communicate one to another anymore. And what they would do to start off the experiment, they would show a picture, and they would show it to one hemisphere. Now, doing that, you would cover the right eye, which would cover the left hemisphere. And the left eye would be the right hemisphere. And they would show a picture, and I guess it's just common for them to use this example, but they would use, for instance, a bottle of Coca-Cola. The next step of the process, they would have both eyes uncovered, and they'd show a series of pictures, but in amongst them would be the bottle of Coca-Cola. And which one do you think that they would pick? Well, I haven't told you any others, but they obviously picked the Coca-Cola. The interesting part, besides this fact, was when they were asked why they chose it. And it's interesting that in each case, they would fabricate an answer. Oh, I was thirsty. Oh, I like Coca-Cola. None of them seemed to respond, oh, well, you have me here in this laboratory, and when you have me doing these tests, I just seem to do strange things. It was as if their conscious will had nothing to do with the choice that they made. And this is very frightening. I don't know if people realize the consequences of this being capable of happening. But yet, it's happening every time we watch television. Particularly if we're watching entertainment. And some education programming can be set forth as entertainment. And this example, I've been looking at the brain, and for a while it was sort of interesting. Brother Morgan brought a video with him by Little Light Ministries, and they demonstrated certain aspects of this, that when you advertise, you hypnotize. This is becoming the trend now in the world, that people are drawn with this power that's beyond their conscious will. Is that of God to work this way? And there are other incidents sort of similar to this. I don't know if you've ever heard of anosognosia. It's a condition, the patient has lost one of the ability to move a limb. This is usually the result of stroke. And the person can move, they're asked to move one limb, and they say, okay, that's fine. But when they can't move the other limb, they give an excuse. The most pronounced type of anosognosia is Anton Blubinsky syndrome. These are people who are caudally blind. They deny being blind, and when they're asked, for instance, how many fingers they see, they'll make a guess, and if they're wrong, they'll give an excuse. It seems like they don't have a choice, but they just give an excuse. Oh, well, I don't have my glasses, or I seem to have mucus in my eyes, I can't see. It's almost like they don't realize that they're blind. In fact, these are what are termed by some scientists as disorders of consciousness. There seems to be a roundabout way getting past the conscious will. And we should be shocked. We should be shocked that a person responds to stimuli in a manner that is not in harmony with their free will. Rather, is a reaction that is governed by, apparently, a reaction. But yet, every time you turn on the television, you expose yourself to something that can do this. And I might add that for quite some time, they've been increasing this, not just their use of it, but how they use it. The technology is increasing. They have faster screen rates. They have things in three dimensions. They have them vibrate, sort of like when we print, what you're looking at in what looks like full color is actually four colors that are aligned in such a way. But what they're doing is they're creating dots, as it were, that move as the film goes on. It enhances the three the 3D effect that they create. And people are held spellbound, powerless. Their emotional centers of their brain become, as it were, unaware. And it's amazing, even without, even if any of this was not true, the amount of wicked things they're shown. There are hundreds of channels. There are, I don't know, 30 to 50 programs per channel. And there's an endless supply of commercials. It's no wonder the evil is increasing in the world. But yet this is only part of it. There's music. There's things on the radio. We're counseled that we're to guard the avenues of our soul. If we'll turn to Psalms 119. Verse 37, Psalms 119, verse 37. It says, turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity, and quicken thou me in thy way. And it is emptiness. That is what vanity means. It's like a bubble. You pop it and it's gone. And people think that they have something. They go to the store and they spend their resources on buying entertainment. They go to football games. They buy books, even the books that you're viewing them and their suggestions, they're written out. But it says here, quicken thou me in thy way. Where is God's way?
Sanctuary.
Granny Ann's not here right now, but I don't want to steal her thunder. But in the sanctuary, it's taught justification, sanctification, and glorification. And at this camp meeting, we're concentrating a lot on sanctification, but you really can't help but go over the other two when you talk about it. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians 3:18. Second Corinthians 3:18, it says, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. This is a very important principle. If we beholding God can be changed into the same image as God, and the same principle must stand that we beholding evil can be changed into that which is evil.
That's right.
Full turn to Romans chapter 12 and verse 17. Romans chapter 12, verse 17. It says, recompense no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. Now, when we watched, or when we did watch television, what we were looking at was, we saw a guy who was supposed to be a good guy, but was really a not so good guy, returning evil for the evil he was given. This is one of the things that's commonly portrayed in the media. And if we watch that, we partake in it. And by beholding it, We increase the likelihood that we'll do the same. Turn to Psalms 101. Verse 3 says, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. Well, if we're not putting something before our eyes, how can it cleave to us? When we're printing, our plates have a substance on it. It's based on the fact that grease and water don't mix. The water does not stick to the image area, so therefore it picks up the ink and prints it. That's what we want to be like. We not the image area, but we don't want to have the wickedness of the world clinging to us. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8. I think most of us know this by heart or even by singing it. Philippians 4, 8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Thank you. We should be looking constantly to the good example and not set before us the evil. And looking at verse 9, it says, those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. And notice Paul says, and seen in me. Paul is setting an example. He was taught of God, the gospel. Excuse me. And he was setting forth the example he was given. He was beholding Christ. And Christ is the perfect example. Mm-hmm. We'll turn to the book of Daniel. And I don't just want to talk simply about, you know, television, but we're mentioning the avenues, so our eyes are the most important. But what we hear also, the music that we listen to. Daniel chapter 3 and verse 5. Says that at what time ye shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye shall fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king hath set up. Now this is pagan worship. They were told to worship an idol. But does God want us to listen to all kinds of music?
No.
We'll turn to Psalms chapter 92. Psalms chapter 92. starting at verse 1, it says, "It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High, to shew forth thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness every night. Upon an instrument of 10 strings and upon the psalmistry, upon the harp with a solemn sound."
And what verse was that?
Verses 1 through 3, Psalms 92. In James chapter 5, James chapter 5 and verse 13, it says, "Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms." And if we read through the psalms, if you read through many portions of the Bible, and that we have many scripture songs, they all glorify God, they all speak of God. They are all virtuous. They are uplifting, and they will build our moral characters. If we turn to Deuteronomy chapter 14, it says in verse 2, Deuteronomy 14, verse 2, "For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God, and the Lord hath chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself above all the nations that are upon the earth. Thou shalt not eat any abominable thing." And the connection between what we eat and how we think is a very great connection. If we're eating a lot of too much fat, if we're drinking caffeinated beverages, there are many things that it will hinder our minds so they don't function correctly. In Proverbs chapter 23, if we'll turn there. Proverbs 23, verses 31, 32. It says, "Look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it giveth his color in the cup, when it moveth itself aright. At the last it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder." And this continues on, speaking about how you'll be drawn into other perverse things. But if you weaken your mind, you'll be drawn away from God. Ephesians chapter 5, if we'll turn there. Ephesians 5, 2, it says in verse 2, "And walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor." The Bible talks about the sweet smell of sacrifice. In Colossians chapter 3 and verse 16, if we'll turn there. Colossians 3:16. It says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him." And if we'll turn to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. Verse 1, it says, "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God." And it's God's will that he develop a people upon this earth that are sinless and have his character. This is his will for the last days that Paul in his writing spoke of that would come throughout the Bible. But how do we renew our minds? It's through daily partaking of the Word of God. We'll open up to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Well, we've been there already. I think. Yeah, we've been there. But, you know, it's talking about perfection, that the scripture is good for perfection. We can go there again and read it. It's always good. Repetition is always good. Second Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. It says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." Righteousness is right doing. Amen. So we have instruction of how to do that which is right. "That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." What does it mean to be furnished? That's right. When you have a house, you stock it, you furnish it with that which you will need. Otherwise, it's not much of a house. Fortunately, you would have a roof over your head. But we are to have all the accoutrements that we need, all the tools. If we'll turn to John chapter 3. The Gospel of John, chapter 3, and verse 14, John 3:14. It says, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Do we believe this? Do we believe that God sent his son?
Amen, man.
That's transforming truth. But we see in the Bible that there's a plan to save man. If we'll turn to Ezekiel chapter 18. Verse 31. It says, cast away from you all your transgressions, whereby ye have transgressed, and make you a new heart, make you a new heart and a new spirit. For why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of him that dieth, saith the Lord God. Wherefore, turn yourselves and live ye. God is offering us a way to be saved. Do you ask, what shall I do to be saved? You must lay hold of Jesus and the word that he has given us. We're told that this Bible that we each are carrying, that through the years, Jesus is responsible for the giving of it. That you must lay aside your preconceived opinions, your hereditary and cultivated ideas at the door of investigation. If you search the scriptures to vindicate your own opinions, you'll never reach the truth. So we're talking about what we allow in if we watch television or listen to music, but what about the false prophet? If we have a Bible that's twisted or being twisted, we'll never reach the truth. And if we have preconceived notions, then we are leading ourselves astray. You must search to learn what the Lord says. If conviction comes as you search, if you see that your cherished opinions are not in harmony with the truth, do not misinterpret the truth in order to suit your own belief, but accept the light given. Open mind and heart that you may behold wondrous things out of God's word.
Amen.
Faith in Christ as the world's Redeemer calls for the acknowledgement of the enlightened intellect, controlled by a heart that can discern and appreciate heavenly treasure. This faith is inseparable from repentance and transformation of character. To have faith means to find and accept the gospel treasure with all the obligations which it imposes. John chapter 3, verse 3. And Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. We have to be certain that we are converted, that we are on the path towards transformation, and that we are being transformed. Without regeneration through faith in Jesus' blood, there is no remission of sins. We can come here and learn many precious truths, but if we don't apply them in our lives, and sometimes we backslide, sometimes we falter. He offers mercy. But if we aren't doing what we're supposed to be doing, our sins won't be forgiven. And right now, our sins are being covered, but they will be uncovered if we do not carry through, if we do not carry through to the end. God will not accept a half heart. We must bring all to Him. We must fall on the rock of salvation. In Acts 17, and we can turn there in Acts 17. Verses 10 and 11. It says, "And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those at Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Therefore, many of them believed, also of honorable women which were Greeks, and of men, not a few." This needs to be our experience. We need to search daily and make it a part of us. And we need to be willing to bring our weaknesses before God. If we have trouble, then if we ask of Him, He will help us. If we don't open up the scriptures daily, He can help us do it. He can help wake us in the morning. Psalms 119. Psalms 119, verse 69. It says, "The proud have forged a lie against me, but I will keep thy precepts with my whole heart." Their heart is as fat as grease, but I delight in thy law. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. This is, there are many who lie against us and against God. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Verses 1 and 2, it says, "Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God." So that there are those who handle this word of God deceitfully. There's some who don't even think of this as possible, and there are many churches that don't even consider that there could be wolves among their flock. They listen to their pastors, and they don't go as the Bereans and look themselves. If we'll turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. In verse 3, it says, "But I fear lest by any means, as a serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." Satan is constantly trying to bring our thought, center of thought, our frontal lobe into submission to our lower passions, the lower portions of the brain that you know, we were talking about our sight and our hearing and that which we eat, but there is chemistry in our brains that work and tell us when we're hungry. And if we've practiced sin, we have recollection of that sin. And we also have a sin that in our past, parents can hand down genetically weak tissue to their children, and that's not to say that they're handing down, you know, cancer necessarily, but when it comes to sin, we can pass on that weakness, that tendency. And the human race has been corrupted and polluted with a tendency to hide from God, to run away, to break His word. And Satan is constantly seeking to bring our mind under these powers, these influences of our mind and of our flesh. If he can fasten the mind upon things of the world, upon that which we desire, he will endeavor to excite our emotions, to arouse the passions, the affections on that which is not good. We are to hold every passion under control, in calm subjection to reason and conscience, then Satan loses his power to control the mind. There's a direct link between our looseness, our lack of self-control, and how Satan influences us. We must bring ourselves under submission of Christ, and He'll give us the power. The is a natural tendency for our minds to find the path of least resistance. It's so easy to be entertained. And we need to understand that there's one who can help us. There's great energy that is expelled. Our bodies need a lot of energy to keep the upper mind over in control of the rest of the body. But God can help us. And of course, if we're doing that which we're required, by keeping our bodies into submission, it becomes easier for eating the diet that we should have. If we're not listening to corrupt music, if we're listening to good music, you know, our body and things will improve and it will help us. But true power comes from He who gives it, and that is the Father of Heaven. There have been some tests that have been done. It was discovered that people, when they have someone that they are comfortable with, that's highly, what's the word I'm looking for? Excitable, emotional. I can't think of the exact word. A lot of preachers, black preachers are known for this, but what's the word?
Charismatic.
Yeah, charismatic, the charismatic movement. But a person is highly charismatic. When a person identifies on a certain level with them, they actually will surrender their will to that person. And this is not what God has ordained. And it's happening. People are learning in the world when they give not just advertisements, but they're learning some ministers, and some people are just naturally this way, but when they're highly emotional, they draw people to them in an unnatural fashion. And we are told that the gospel should be comprehended intellectually before it is emotional. Our emotions are an avenue through which Satan can reach us. But I thank God that He has given us His Word. And as the Sabbath, I was very much touched by Brother Fred's message talking about the promises in the Bible. That Sister White says that, you know, there's so many sins that could be so more easily overcome if we would just claim hold of these promises. If we'll understand that God has given us this book for our betterment. But unfortunately, sometimes we distract ourselves, either of ourselves or looking towards interests in that other ministers or teachers of this world have to offer. There really shouldn't be much more that we should need other than the Bible. God has given us the writings of the Last Day Prophet for us to be drawn more closely to the Bible, to understand it more. And when I first approached writing this message, it was just so hard because there's just so much information in the Bible. Where do you go? But the avenues of our soul are so important. And my appeal is that we guard them more carefully and that we guard ourselves using the tools that we are given. We have the Spirit of God. That if we pray to God, He will answer us. And He has given us instruction in His Word if we will hold on to that and claim the promises. And if we will sing psalms before we go out, we can go into a store and there'll be music playing, but we won't be affected. Hopefully we won't go into a place presumptuously where there's rioting and drunkenness. But I thank you for your time and